The Diamond Sutra. I love Gautam the Buddha because he represents to me the essential core of religion. He is not the founder of Buddhism. Buddhism is a byproduct. But he is the beginner of a totally different kind of religion in the world. He is the founder of a religionless religion. Yes, indeed, religionless religion. He has propounded no religion, instead religiousness. And this is the great radical change in the history of human consciousness. That instead of propounding a religion, his focus was on religiousness. Before Buddha, there were religions, but never a pure religiousness. Man was not yet matured. With Buddha, humanity entered into a mature age. All human beings have not yet entered into that. That is indeed true. But Buddha has heralded the path. Buddha has opened the gateless gate. It takes time for human beings to understand such a deep message. Buddha's message is the deepest ever. No one has done so much of work that Buddha has done, and the way he has done it. Nobody else represents pure fragrance. Other founders of the religion and other enlightened ones had compromised with their audience. Buddha never compromised. He remains uncompromised, and this is the reason of his purity. He does not care whether you understand. He cares only what is the truth and what the truth is, and he says it without being worried whether you understand it or not. In a way, it is hard. In a way, this is great compassion that he is not bringing the truth to your level. The moment the rain clouds form and it starts falling, it is the purest form of water. But when it mixes up with earth's atmosphere of cloud, dust, and many other things, the water drops becomes contaminated. So when the truth is to be communicated or brought down to your level, it will get contaminated. So instead of that, he tries to raise your level of consciousness from where you are or where it is at the moment, and takes you to the horizon where he is so that he can communicate to you. It's like he takes you to his operation theater. He takes you to his theater of consciousness, where he is, from where he operates, communicates all that is to be communicated, and it transports you back to the place wherever you are. This is great compassion. Truth has to be set as it is. The moment you compromise, or the moment you bring truth to the ordinary level of human consciousness, it loses its soul. It becomes superficial. It becomes a dead thing. You cannot bring truth to the level of human beings. Instead, human beings have to be led to the level of truth. And that is Buddha's great work. 25 centuries ago, just someday, early in the morning like this, the sutra that we call Diamond Sutra was born. 1,250 monks were present. It happened in the great city of Shravasti. It was a city, a great one in those days. The word Shravasti means the city of glory. It was one of the glorious cities of the ancient India. It had 900,000 families living in it. Now that city has completely disappeared. A very small village exists and you will not find even its name on any map. Even the name has disappeared. Now it is called Sahib Mahib. It is impossible to believe that such a great city ever existed there. This is the way of life. Things go on changing. Cities turn into cemeteries and cemeteries turn into cities. Life is a flux. Buddha must have loved that city of Shravasti. Out of his 45 years of his ministry, he stayed in Shravasti for 25 years. And the rest of the time, he was moving from place to place. He must have loved the people. The people must have been of much evolved consciousness. All the great sutras of Buddha, almost all were born in Shravasti. This sutra, Diamond Sutra, was also born in Shravasti. The Sanskrit name for this sutra is Vajrachedika Prajnaparamit Sutra. It comes from the word Vajra, means thunderbolt. Thunderbolt is the official weapon of the Hindu god Indra. Is known as Vajra. Thunderbolt is the English name. Chedika means that which penetrates. Prajna means wisdom. Paramit means perfect or total. It means perfection of wisdom. And when wisdom has attained to its totality or perfection, then it acts like a thunderbolt and it cuts all that is superficial. If your intelligence has reached to that level, it can see beyond time and space. You take no time to respond. This is what the master represents. You go and ask him a question. He looks at your question, looks at your query and gives his answer. If you allow Buddha, he can cut you like a thunderbolt. He can behead you. He can kill you and help you to be reborn. A Buddha is both a murderer and a mother. On one hand, he has to kill you, and on the other hand, he has to give you a new being. The new being is possible only when the old has been destroyed. A new structure can only come into being when the old has disappeared. From the ashes of the old, new is born. Man is a phoenix. The mythological word phoenix is not just a mythology, it is a metaphor. It stands for man. That phoenix exists nowhere except in man. Man is the being who has to die to be reborn. This is what Jesus said to Nicodemus. Nicodemus was a professor, a learned person, a rabbi, a member of the board that controlled the great temple of Jerusalem. One dark night he came to see Jesus. He could not gather courage to come to him in the daytime. He was afraid what people would say. He was so respectful and respected. Going to a vagabond teacher like Jesus, or going to someone who is hated by all the rabbis and the learned ones, or going to somebody who moves with thieves, drunkards and prostitutes. But something in him was very desirous to see this man. Maybe he has seen Jesus walking, coming to the temple. He must have something deep within his being, deep within his unconscious for this man. He could not hold himself back. One night when everybody had left, when even the disciples had gone to sleep, he reached Jesus and asked, "What should I do that I can also enter the kingdom of God?" And Jesus said, "Unless you die, nothing is possible. If you die, only then you can enter into the kingdom of God. You will have to die as you are, and only then you will be reborn as really you, your inner being is. You are not living in harmony with your inner being. Your inner and outer have two different faces. The ego has to die for the essential being to surface. And that is the meaning of Vajra Chedika Prajna Param. It cuts like a thunderbolt. In one stroke it can destroy you. And one of the greatest sermons of Buddha is Diamond Sutra. Get in tune with it. Before we enter into the sutra, a few things needed to be understood that will help you to understand it even better. Gautam, the Buddha, had started a spirituality that is non-repressive, non-ideological. It is a very rare phenomenon. The ordinary kind of spirituality, the garden variety, is very repressive. It depends on repression. It does not transform you. It only cripples man. It does not liberate. Instead, it enslaves the man. It is oppressive and ugly. Buddha does not give you nirvana as an ideal. He liberates instead of coercing. Buddha teaches you how to live, not for any goal, not to achieve anything, but to be blissful here and now. There is a great difference. You live for certain goals, and when goals are not achieved or there is a delay, you are unhappy. Buddha teaches you how to be blissful here and now, this very moment. Buddha teaches you how to live in awareness. Not that awareness is going to give you something. Remember, awareness is not a means to anything. Instead, it is the end in itself. The means and the ends, both. Its value is intrinsic. Buddha does not teach you the otherworldliness. It has to be understood. People are worldly. The priest goes on teaching the otherworldly. The other world is also not very otherworldly. It cannot be, because it is just an improved model of the same world. From where will you create the other world? You know only this world. Your imagination can be built on that alone. You can improve. You can decorate the other world better. You can remove a few things here and there. And things that were ugly here, so you replace with a few things which you think will be beautiful. But it is going to be a creation out of the experience of this world. Unless you have experienced something different. This is why there are different courses of interior designing. You have known a particular kind of interior designing based on your experience. So you go to someone who has the capability to give you a better interior design. So Buddha is the one. It comes out of your mind. It is a game of imagination. You will have beautiful women there. Of course, more beautiful than you have here. You will have the same kind of pleasures there, maybe more permanent and stable. They will be the same kind of pleasures, of course. You will have better food, more tasty, but you will have food. You will have houses, maybe made out of gold, with a better interior. You will repeat the whole thing again and again. Just go into the scriptures and see how they depict the heaven, and you will find the same world improved upon. A few touches here and there, based on the imagination. But it is not in any way the otherworldly. That is why I say the otherworldliness of the other religions is not very otherworldly. It is this world projected into the future. It is born out of the experience of this world. There will not be misery, poverty, illness, paralysis, blindness and deafness in that. Things that you do not like here will not be there, and things you like will be there in abundance. But it is not going to be anything new. Mind cannot conceive of anything new. Mind is incapable of conceiving the new. It lives in the old, and in fact the mind is old. The new never happens through the mind. The new happens only when mind is not functioning. When mind is not controlling you, when mind has been put aside, the new happens only when mind is not interfering. But all your scriptures talk about heaven, and the heaven or paradise or Firdaus or Swarg is nothing but the same story. It may be printed on a better art paper, with better ink, in a more improved press, with more colorful illustrations, but the story remains the same. It cannot be otherwise. Buddha does not talk of otherworldliness or the other world. He simply teaches you how to be here in this world, how to be here alert, conscious and mindful, so that nothing impinges upon your emptiness. And your inner emptiness is not contaminated or poisoned. Buddha teaches you how to live here and yet remain uncontaminated and unpolluted. He teaches you how you can be in the world and the world will not be within you. The otherworldly spirituality is bound to be oppressive, destructive and sadomasochistic. It is indeed pathological. Buddha's spirituality has a different flavor to it. It has the flavor of no ideal, no future, and no other world. It is a flower here, now. It asks for nothing. All is already given. It simply becomes more alert so that you can see more. You can hear more, you can be more. Remember, you are only in the same proportion as is your consciousness. If you want to be more conscious then. Consciousness imparts being. Unconsciousness takes the being away. When you are drunk, you lose your being. When you are fast asleep, you lose being. Have you not washed it? When you are alert, you have a different quality. You are centered and rooted. When you are alert, you feel the solidity of your being. It is almost tangible. When you are unconscious, just dragging by, sleepy, your sense of being is less. It is always in the same proportion as the consciousness is. So Buddha's whole message is to be conscious or mindful. And for no reason, just for the sake of being conscious. Consciousness imparts being. Consciousness creates you. And mindfulness creates you so different from that you are. This you cannot imagine. It represents you where I has disappeared, where no idea of self exists, nothing defines you, only pure emptiness or infinity or unbounded emptiness. This Buddha calls the state of meditation or some samadhi, the right state of meditation. When you are all alone, but remember, aloneness is not loneliness. Have you ever thought about this beautiful word alone? It means all one. It is made up of two words, all and one. In aloneness, you become one with all. Aloneness has nothing of loneliness in it. You are not lonely when you are alone. You are alone but not lonely because you are one with all. How can you be lonely? You do not miss the other two. Not that you have forgotten them. Not that you do not need them. Not that you do not care about them. No. You do not remember other because you are one with them. All the distinction between one and all has vanished. One has become the all and all has become one. This is the meaning of the word alone. Buddha says some samadhi is aloneness. The right meditation is to be so utterly alone that you are one with all. Let me explain this to you. If you are empty, your boundaries disappear. Because emptiness has no boundaries. Your house has boundaries, every room has a boundary because it is that emptiness, that empty space is bounded by restrictions. Emptiness cannot have any weight. Emptiness cannot have any color. Emptiness cannot have any name. Emptiness cannot have any form. When you are empty, how can you divide yourself from the other? Because you do not have any color, you do not have any name or any form, there are no boundaries. How can you go on making any distinction? There is an empty piece of land, no rooms to be known as bedroom, kitchen, restroom, or anything else. When you are empty, you are one with all. All the rooms, the spaces, the bounden spaces has become free and one with all. You have melted into existence. The inner space of each room has melted into the wholeness. You are no more an island. You have become the vast continent of being. Buddha's whole message is condensed in this one word, samsamadhi, the right meditation. What is the right meditation? When meditation attains to fruition, the meditator is no more, the ego is no more. Instead, there is utter emptiness. Out of that emptiness, bliss overflows, love surrounds, light manifests. The three words, bliss, love, and light belong to the same domain, or three faces of that which is truth or reality. If the meditator still exists, then it is wrong meditation. If the meditator is dissolved in meditation, then it is the right meditation. And right meditation brings you to emptiness and aloneness. The whole sutra is concerned with how to become utterly empty. This is the basic gift of Buddha to the world, the Diamond Sutra.